Hello everyone. In the previous lecture, we talked about combinational logic circuits. In this lecture, we'll talk about the sequential logic circuits. As discussed in the previous lecture, sequential logic circuits employ memory elements in addition to logic gates, and the current output depends both on the present as well as past inputs, because the output depends on the present input and the state of the memory element. That in turn depends on the previous input. So the block diagram of a sequential logic circuit looks something like this. It would have inputs being fed into a combinational circuit. The current output of the combinational circuit will be fed to a memory element. And the state of the memory element is again fed back into the combinational circuit. So sequential logic circuits employ feedback. So the current output depends on the output of the gates as well as on the state of the memory elements. And the output of the gates depend on the state of the memory element. A particular type of sequential logic circuits that employ signals that affect the memory elements only at discrete instants of time, those type of logic circuits are called synchronous sequential logic systems. That means they will have an additional clock signal being fed into the memory element, and the clock signal will determine exactly at which instant this change in state should take place. It should not take place at all times. It should take place only when the clock signal changes its value. Okay, so this is just to synchronize the states and the inputs. This is why this kind of system is called synchronous sequential logic circuit. Okay. We also know that a bistable multivibrator can serve as a memory element. Why? Because a bistable multivibrator has only two stable states, the circuit can remain in one of those stable states indefinitely until there is some external trigger that makes it change its state, right? That is why a bistable multivibrator can serve as a memory element, and as the name bistable suggests, it can have only two stable outputs. So one such memory element, which is a fundamental basic sequential logic circuit, is called flip-flop. So flip-flops are basic memory elements used in clocked sequential circuits, and flip-flops can be made using NOR or NAND logic circuits. Okay, so you can make an entire flip-flop using just NOR or just NAND gates. So there are different types of flip-flops, like RS flip-flop, JK flip-flop, T flip-flop, and D flip-flop. But the most basic one which we will be discussing today is RS flip-flop, or it's also called SR flip-flop. The SR flip-flop, as the name suggests, would have two inputs, S and R, and S comes from the word set and R comes from the word reset. And we'll see in a while why it is called set and reset. Okay. Again, the SR flip-flop can be implemented using NAND logic, or it can be implemented using NOR logic. In this lecture, we are discussing the NOR logic, and you can develop a corresponding converse of this using the NAND gate. So one thing we need to keep in mind about the NOR gate is what happens in different cases. So for a NOR gate, let's write it down on the side. This is the output of a NOR gate. What does this tell us? That the output is equal to 1 only when both inputs are 0, right? And the output is 0 when even any one of the inputs is 1. Right? So this is something very important, and we will just keep it on the side so that we don't forget it, because we'll be using it again and again. Now, as we discussed earlier, that a sequential circuit or a memory element is going to employ feedback, right? So this is how a NOR gate based SR flip-flop looks like. We would have two NOR gates. In one gate, I'm going to give the input R. The other gate, I'm going to give the input S, okay? The output of the R gate, which let me call it gate number 1, and let me call this gate 2. The output of the gate to which R was the input, let us call it Q for now. and the output of the gate to which S is the input, gate number 2, that is Q dash. Now, why it has to be Q and Q dash, we'll see that in just a little while. But understand that these two outputs are expected to be complements of each other. Okay, normally they are expected to be complements of each other. What will happen if they were not complements of each other? We'll see in just a little while. Now, because this involves feedback, the output from the first gate is fed as an input to the second gate. And similarly, the output of the second gate is fed as an input to the first gate. This is how an SR flip-flop looks like. Now let us see what is going to happen for different values of S and R, right? So let us assume to start with, and we'll note these values here on a truth table on the side. We'll note what are the values of Q and Q dash. Let us start if S was equal to 1 and R was equal to 0. So this is 0 and this is 1. We know that the output of a NOR gate is 0 if any one of the inputs is 1, right? So obviously, because S is equal to 1, the output of gate number 2 is going to be 0, right? We don't know what will be the output of gate 1 immediately because it could be 1 or it could be 0. But since Q dash is fed back as an input to gate 1 and Q dash is 0, that means this is 0, right? That means both inputs to this gate number 1 are 0. That means Q is equal to 1. And if Q equal to 1 is fed back, both inputs are 1. If both inputs of a NOR gate are 1, the output is still 0. So this is fine. This state kind of looks like stable, right? And this is how it's going to be. How? That if S is equal to 1, R is equal to 0, Q is equal to 1, and Q dash is equal to 0. So if you notice, if the set bit was equal to 1, you can say that output is, in quotes, set to high. Right? If I consider set to be high and reset to mean 0, when set bit is on, right, when the set input is on or set input is high, the output is high. Okay? And this is the main output, the normal output we are talking about. Q dash should be its complement. So this was the scenario corresponding to this input. Now let us remove both inputs and see what happens. So let S also be equal to 0 now, and R is already 0. Okay. So I'm looking at the next state where set bit is removed and it is now made equal to 0. We notice since the previous feedback is 1, the output of gate number 2 is still going to be 0. And since this is fed back to gate number 1, the output of gate number 1 is again still going to be 1. This 1 being fed back, this condition of Q equal to 1 and Q dash equal to 0 remains unchanged even when I removed the set bit, right? So if S was equal to 0 and R was equal to 0, and this is the condition after S was equal to 1 and R was equal to 0. After that, when both bits are set to 0, the output remains unchanged. That means the output was high and it remains high. That means to set the output equal to 1, all you needed was to give a high input on the set bit. Okay, and once the set bit is high, then output is high. Even if you remove these inputs, then the output remains at high. Now let us look at the other case where S would be 0 and R would be equal to 1. That means this is 1 and this is 0. Okay, so with the same logic as before, if even any one of the inputs is 1, the output is going to be 0. This is fed back to this gate. That means the output of gate number 2 is going to be 1 since both inputs are 0. This being fed back here, both inputs are 1, output is going to be 0. So this is a stable state. And what is the observation? The observation is that when R is equal to 1, the output is 0. Or in other words, we could say that when reset bit is high, the output is reset. Reset typically would mean set back to 0, right? So if I write this, if S was 0 and R was 1, the output is 0 and Q dash is equal to 1. All right. The previous case, this is called set case and this case is called the reset case. Because when reset bit is high, the output is zero. Or you can say output has been reset. Now let us see what happens if we remove these inputs now. That means S is still equal to zero, but R is also now zero. What do we notice? That due to the previous feedback, the output of gate 2 is still 1 because both inputs are zeros, and this 1 being fed back, even when R was equal to 0, the output of gate number 1 is still 0. That means the output does not change. So if S is equal to 0, R equal to 0 again, and this is after reset bit was 1, we notice that the output remains unchanged. It remains reset. Okay, so this is how a set input and a reset input, their respective values being high, can set or reset the output or the state of this flip-flop. Okay, and then even if you remove the inputs, because of this particular property of feedback, we observe that the output remains unchanged. If we had set it and removed the inputs, it remains set. If we reset it and then remove the inputs, it remains reset. This is the normal functioning of an SR flip-flop. So it remembers the previous state, right? This is how it acts as a memory element. Now, what would happen if S and R both were equal to 1? S is equal to 1 and R is also equal to 1. Okay, so both of these are 1. As it appears, if any one of the inputs of a NOR gate is 1, the output should be 0. That means this would be 0. If this is fed back, this is also 0. So this is something strange, right? Because if S is equal to 1, R is equal to 1, Q is also 0 and Q dash is also 0. And we just saw that for the normal operation of a flip-flop, they have to be complement, right? That is what we found. For set condition and for reset condition, we always found that Q and Q dash were complement of each other. So what's the big deal about this situation? The big deal about this situation, the problem with this situation, is that once this happens, now remember, why are we using flip-flops? These are basic memory elements. That means if we set a particular state, we need the output to remain in that state when the inputs have been removed. So suppose S was equal to 1 and R is equal to 1. And we notice that Q is 0 and Q dash is also 0, which is strange. But let's accept it for a second. What would happen if now the inputs were removed? That means R is also 0 and S is also 0 after S and R both had been 1 in the previous case. Now what happens? All right, so I'm just retaining the previous outputs, both of which were 0. And now S is also equal to 0 and R is also equal to 0. All right, both inputs to a NOR gate are 0. That means output should be equal to 1. The same holds here. The output should be equal to 1. But if this is the case and this is what is being fed back, that means this is no longer 0. This should be equal to 1. Similarly, if this is what is being fed back, this should no longer be 0. This should be equal to 1. Right, because Q is equal to 1. But if one of the inputs to the NOR gates is 1, right, we know that the output is equal to 0. That means output should be 0 and this also should be 0. But wait a second. If Q is again 0, that means what is being fed back is again not 1. It should again be 0. Similarly, this again should not be 1. It should again be 0. That means this again should not be 0. It should be 1. This should not be 0, this should be 1. So what you notice is that the gates are going to keep changing their states in an indefinite way if they were switching at the same time. That means if the switching was happening at the same time, at the exact same time, after S equal to 1, R equal to 1, if exactly at the same instant S is equal to 0 and R equal to 0 takes place, then the output is just going to keep on fluctuating between 0 and 1 and we will not know, right? We are back to square 1. And this is going to go on, which is why such a state is called indeterminate. Indeterminate, and it is an invalid state. So we have to always be careful while using an SR flip-flop that this condition, S equal to 1, R equal to 1, should be avoided. Why it should be avoided? Because once s equal to 1, r equal to 1 takes place, then the next state becomes indeterminate. Means you cannot determine what exactly is going to be the output. It could be 1, it could be 0, it would keep on fluctuating. Okay, that is why the output is indeterminate. Such a condition is considered invalid for this flip-flop operation. The best thing to do in an SR flip-flop is to absolutely avoid making s equal to 1, r equal to 1. But this indeterminate condition is going to continue if the two gates keep on switching at the same time. Okay. If, of course, one of the gates switched a fraction of seconds before the other one, that means these two will not have to change state simultaneously. Right? That means if say, this had already taken place, right? We had stopped at this stage. So this output being, at output being 1, we had stopped here. And if one of the inputs is 1, that means output will be 0. And then this situation will be again stable, q equal to 1, q dash equal to 0. But if that doesn't happen, if both these gates keep on switching at the same time, then there is no way to determine what is going to be the output. And this is called the truth table of SR, but in NOR combination. Okay. In NAND, it's going to be the exact opposite. As in that case, when set and reset both are equal to 1, that will be the condition where no change happens. And when s is equal to 0, r is equal to 0, that is the indeterminate state. You can derive the same logic with exactly the same idea by just replacing these gates with NAND gates and see what happens. Note that the reset state is also called the clear state. So before we move on, let us talk briefly about triggering of flip-flops. Now we understand that the state of a flip-flop is switched by a momentary change in the input signal, right? And this momentary change is what is called a trigger, and the transition that it causes is said to trigger the flip-flop, okay, trigger the state of the flip-flop. So asynchronous flip-flops, they require an input trigger defined by the change of signal level. Right? The circuit that we just saw, there the state changed when the value of a signal changed from 0 to 1, right? The value of R and S changed from 0 to 1. This level must be returned to its initial value, like 0, 0 in case of a NOR gate, before the next trigger is applied. Right? So the circuit that we have just seen, that's an example of an asynchronous flip-flop. Okay, there was no clock or anything. Clocked synchronous flip-flops are triggered by pulses, and the duration of the pulse is a critical factor. Another thing to note here is that the circuit that we just saw, the standalone NOR combination, that is often also called the SR latch. And often when this SR latch is clocked, then it is often referred to as flip-flop. Okay, but the term is interchangeably used. So what do we mean by this pulse? You remember the block diagram we saw earlier, where we saw that there's a feedback path between the combinational circuit and memory elements, and there may be a timing mismatch, right, between the memory elements changing their state and the combinational circuit changing its state, because the output of the combinational circuit is an input to this memory element. So the timing problem can be prevented if the output of the flip-flops do not start until the pulse input has returned to zero. Right? So because a clock pulse is being fed and only at certain instances will we be recording the output, this whole problem would be avoided if the flip-flop output does not start until the pulse has again returned to zero, right? So to ensure this, what we must do? We must ensure that the flip-flop has a signal propagation delay from an input to output, because from the input of the memory element to the output, this memory element is what is a flip-flop, all right? So to ensure this, what we need to do is the flip-flop must have a signal propagation delay from input to output greater than the pulse duration. However, so this path can produce instability if the output of the memory element, that is the output of the flip-flop, is continuously changing while the output of the combinational circuit, which is actually the input to this flip-flop, that is also being sampled by the clock pulse. Instead of having to control the duration of the pulse so that, you know, the delay is greater than the pulse duration, instead of that, a better way to ensure delay is to make the flip-flop sensitive to pulse transition rather than pulse duration. And this type of triggering is called edge triggering. So if we look at a pulse, this particular edge is called the rising edge or the positive edge. Right? And this particular edge, where the signal falls from 1 to 0, this is called the falling edge or the negative edge. So when we make this transition change only at this instant or at this instant, this is called edge triggering. And depending on which type of edge we are using to mark the triggering, the system may be called positive edge triggered or negative edge triggered. So when we have to draw a flip-flop in a circuit, this is its circuit symbol. Okay, this is currently unclocked. So this is an SR latch. If I bring in a clock, we will have to write it like this. If this was positive edge triggered, we would use this symbol. If we were using negative edge triggering, we would use this symbol. Okay. I'm not going into the details of how this positive edge triggered clock or negative edge triggered clock is generated. For now, I'm just considering it to be a simple positive edge triggered clock. So this standalone SR latch that we saw, if on this circuit we introduce a clock signal, okay, let us call it CLK. Okay, so to make sure that only when the clock is 1, then this transition takes place, we are going to use an AND gate. Such that the clock is an input to both these AND gates, and the R and the S are both inputs along with the clock to this AND gate. So only when clock is equal to 1 and R equal to 1, you'll get an output as 1. Okay, so this is called a clocked SR flip-flop. Okay, so let us redraw the truth table of this RS flip-flop so that we can arrive at the characteristic equation of such an RS flip-flop. Right, so this is how the truth table looks like. Now the characteristic table is also like the truth table, but let us say the present output is QT and the next output after a certain time, let us call it as QT plus 1. So this characteristic table basically helps us obtain this next output as a function of this present output and the values of S and R. Okay, so let us draw this characteristic table. So it's just like the truth table, but just inputs and outputs have changed. We are now saying that output function is the next output and arguments are present output, S and R, right? So let's write all possible combinations, right? So what we can see from the truth table is that at the onset itself, these two cases, when S is equal to 1 and R is equal to 1, these are indeterminate, right? So these are don't care conditions as far as we are concerned. Now, from the truth table, we can also see that when S is equal to 0 and R is equal to 0, these two cases, the output does not change. That means whatever was the previous output, the next output is also going to be the same thing. That means if previous output was 0, next output is also 0. If previous output was 1, next output is also 1. Okay. Similarly, S equal to 1, R equal to 0 are these two cases, this and this, right? So no matter what is the previous output, the sole job of S equal to 1 is to set the output to 1. That means the output is going to be 1 with no regard to the previous input, all right? And lastly, in the same way, when R is equal to 1 and S is equal to 0, that are these two cases, irrespective of what the previous outputs were, the output will be 0, because that's what is the job of the reset bit. So once we have this table, we can obtain a function, a Boolean function. Let's see if it's possible to minimize this using KMap first. Right, so our minterms are here, here, and here. We also have two don't care conditions. So 010, 100, and 110. And we also have don't care conditions at 011 and 111. So it appears that this could be one grouping. And this could be another grouping. That means we could say that QT plus 1 is from the grouping in red, we could call this as S, plus the grouping in blue is R dash QT. So this is called the characteristic equation, and this is called the characteristic table of an RS flip-flop. Right? And you understand that the major problem with RS flip-flop was this indeterminate condition, right, which we had to avoid at all costs. Now, another type of flip-flop that solves this problem is called the JK flip-flop, and its circuit is something like this. So the circuit looks almost like the clocked SR circuit, with inputs being J and K instead of S and R. And it should be noted that J behaves just like S would have behaved, and K behaves just like the reset input would have behaved. Okay, but the major difference in a JK flip-flop is that this AND receives a feedback from the output Q, and the gate J receives a feedback from the output Q dash. If you look at just the shaded part of the circuit, this is nothing but an SR latch. How does an SR latch behave? If this was equal to 1, then output would have been 1 and this was 0. And if reset was equal to 1 and set was equal to 0, then in that case output would be 0 and Q dash would be 1. Right? This is how it would behave. So it can be shown that this JK flip-flop would behave in the exact same way as an SR flip-flop for cases where J is equal to 1, K is equal to 0. It's going to set Q equal to 1. If J is equal to 0 and K is equal to 1, it is going to give Q equal to 0. That means reset. It can also be shown that if J is equal to 0, K equal to 0, there will be no change. That means whatever was the previous output, it's the same output, just like in SR latch. Let us see what happens when J is equal to 1 and K is equal to 1. Okay, so here let us reiterate the fact that Q is actually ANDed together with K and the clock input. That means the output of this gate would be equal to 1 only if K is equal to 1 and the previous output, that is Q, is equal to 1. Right? That means Q dash is 0. Correct? Also, so we have two cases. One is if Q was equal to 1 and Q dash was 0. And the second case is when Q was equal to 0 and Q dash was equal to 1. Because the other case would be that since Q dash is also ANDed with J, this gate, this flip-flop is set with a clock pulse only when Q dash was equal to 1, right? And Q was equal to 0 at that time. So let us assume that to start with, Q was equal to 1 and Q dash was equal to 0. And in such a situation, both J and K are becoming equal to 1. Right? So the previous case output state is this. Q is equal to 1 and Q dash equal to 0. In such a case, I'm assuming the clock is 1, only then this makes sense. But when K is equal to 1 and previous output is Q, then this, the output of this gate is 1. Similarly, here the output of this gate would be 0, no matter what J is. So if I write the two cases for previous output and next output and their corresponding complement terms, if the previous output was 10, right, this kind of a situation, and J and K was equal to 1, what happens? It appears that the output of this SR latch would be as if when r was equal to 1, right? That is how it looks like, because this is equal to 1 and this is equal to 0. And this is how an SR latch would have behaved when r was equal to 1. That means reset. That means output is 0 and q dash is 1. Similarly, if suppose the previous state is like this, that previous output is, this is 0 and this is 1. What happens in that case when j is equal to 1, k is equal to 1? It is the output of this AND gate that becomes 1 and the output of this AND gate becomes 0 because of this ANDing. Now, if you look at this, this is the case as if when set was equal to 1, that means output is set to 1. That means Q should be equal to 1 and Q dash should be equal to 0, just like how it would be in an SR latch. Okay, so in either case, you notice that that indeterminate condition did not come. It did not happen that the output were in the same state, right? In fact, what we notice is that whatever was the input state, when j is equal to 1 and k is equal to 1, the output is simply complemented. If it was 0, it became 1. If it was 1, it became 0. Okay, so when j is equal to 1 and k is equal to 1, instead of this being an indeterminate condition, this becomes a condition of complementing. So complement of previous output. So let us draw the characteristic table directly. All right, so to obtain next output in terms of previous output and the value of j and k, we notice that if j and k are both zeros, the next output is same as previous output. That means this remains zero and here this would be, remain one, right? When k is equal to one, this acts as a reset. So irrespective of what is the previous output, the next output is zero. Similarly, when j is equal to 1, irrespective of what was the previous output, this is acting as a set. So output is 1. And these two particular cases, when j is equal to 1 and k is equal to 1, the output is complement of the previous output. So if output was 0, the next output is 1. If the previous output was 1, the next output is 0. Let's obtain the function. So this is the best kind of grouping we can get. This tells us that qt plus 1 is simply jq dash plus k dash q. So this is how the JK flip-flop eliminates this indeterminate condition of the SR flip-flop. Now, if we tie the two inputs of this JK flip-flop together, okay, that means we force J and K to be the same all the time. So J and K both can either be 0 or both can be 1. In that case, what is going to happen? When J and K both are 1, that time the output would be complement of whatever was the previous output. And when J and K both are 0, then there will be no change. This kind of a flip-flop is called the T flip-flop, okay, where T stands for the word toggle. So say this is the JK flip-flop. To make it into a T flip-flop, just need to tie the two inputs together and this now becomes a T flip-flop. T coming from the word toggle, meaning just switching between two states. So if we were to write how the next output would vary as a function of the previous output and the value of T, understand that T is nothing but both J and K together. So these are the possible combinations, meaning previous input is 0, previous input is 1. In that case, if T is 0, T is 1, what is the output? If T is equal to 0, meaning J and K both are equal to 0, In that case, present output is same as previous output. That means 0 in this case and 1 in this case. Similarly, if t is equal to 1, that means j is equal to k is equal to 1. In that case, the next output is the complement of the previous output. That means 0 becomes 1 and 1 becomes 0. Okay. So basically what this means is that the t input, and we would now represent it as t flip-flop. Okay. So this t input is simply a toggle input that shows that if its value is 0, then no change. And when its value is 1, then you toggle
or complement.
So this is the characteristic table. And then the next output can simply be written from this table itself as TQ dash plus T dash Q. Right? So you remember that for SR flip-flop, the best solution would be not to allow SNR become equal to 1 at the same time. Right? This could also be done by another type of flip-flop where, if consider an RS flip-flop, so this is S input and this is R, okay, the clock is already there. But instead of giving two inputs that can take different values, if we feed one input to S and just take its complement form and feed it to R, let's call this input as D. This kind of a flip-flop is called a D flip-flop. Okay, so again, the indeterminate condition is going to be eliminated completely because there is no chance that SNR will become 1 at the same time. But this also means that SNR cannot even become 0, 0 at the same time. Correct? So how is this circuit going to behave like? When D is equal to 1, what is going to happen? S will be equal to 1, that means output will be equal to 1, right? When D will be equal to 0, in that case, R will be equal to 1, that means output will be 0. Such a flip-flop has only one input, that is the D, along with the clock, okay? And what does it appear to do? It appears to not care what the previous output. It gives us an output 1 when the value of D is 1, and it gives a value 0 when the value of D is 0. This term D comes from its ability to hold data. Okay, so if I was to draw a characteristic table for a D flip-flop, so previous output D, what would be the next output? If D is equal to 0, output is 0. If D is equal to 1, output is equal to 1. Okay, irrespective of what the previous output was. So if you plug it into KMAP, or directly we can see that the next output is simply the value of D, irrespective of what the previous output was. That means D flip-flop can hold data into its internal storage. Okay, so it just holds the data. The output follows the data input as long as that clock is at 1. So these four were the basic types of flip-flop circuits or memory elements that form the building blocks of sequential logic circuits. There are many more types of sequential logic circuits like registers and counters, which include storage as well as some sort of processing. So please check out such circuits. You may study them in slightly more advanced courses. On that note, thank you and study well.